Start, please.
Very good afternoon and a warm welcome to all. I, Ushashi Roy Sengupta, is a faculty at the Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, Surendranath College for Women. Surendranath College for Women is organizing this web lecture series for the past 1 month. It's the fourth lecture in the series today. Jyoti Shaw, a faculty at the department, was to address you all today, but she could not make it due to a personal bereavement. We extend our condolences to her family, but it was very well organized and very well responsibly handled by Atushi Bhattacharya and Anunna Shen. To just not bring a halt to the series. The series continues. Our presentation is on digital media. The speakers are Atushi Bhattacharya and Anunna Sen. Anunna Sen is a faculty at Surendranath College for Women for the past 4.5 years. She has an experience of working as an English announcer and presenter at All India Radio Kolkata, Akashvani Bhavan. And she is also a visiting faculty at the Birla Institute of Liberal Arts and Management Sciences. Our second presentation or a presenter for the day is Atushi Bhattacharya. She is a faculty and very proud to mention that she's also an alumni of the Department of Journalism and Mass Communication. She's also a research scholar at Guru Jambeshwar University of Science and Technology, Hisar. So regarding the rules that we wish to follow during the presentation is please do not present by yourself. It's a request. It's a humble request. It disturbs the attention of the speakers. And if you have any questions during the session, please type it in the chat box. It will be addressed by the presenters at the end of the session. The feedback link will be shared at the chat box. In the chat box, almost at the very end of the session, please, another humble request, please fill it up very correctly and please add your specifications very clearly. So this is just for your understanding and your consideration. Okay, so thank you. And it's over to Anunna and Atushi.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this warm welcome. We'll start right away. But before that, I would like to take the opportunity to thank Uma Shankar Pandey, sir, Shoto Protocol, sir, you, Ushashi Rai Sengupta, madam, Konka, madam, Sraboni Mukherjee, madam, Atushibi, and Jyoti. So, with your permission, shall I present the screen, please? Hello?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Is it visible to everyone?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much. So today's topic is digital media. So what is digital media? Before saying that, we'll just discuss that in brief what all we are going to cover today in this just half an hour that I'm going to take now. First, we'll discuss the concept and meaning of digital media, then the internet. And then from computing devices, how we, swiftly gradually moved on to smartphones and tablets. Then we'll discuss the binary system, then the digital media and society, followed by digital communication, then digital journalism, and finally, advantages and disadvantages of the digital media. Before starting, I would just like to, you know, take this opportunity to, you know, just mention this line by the historian of technology, Melvin Kranzberg, that technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. What does it mean? It basically means that a technology which we had at our behest is it's neither good nor bad. It's we who decide how to, you know, utilize it. Whether for detriment or whether for the benefit of our social circle at large. Okay, so moving on to the concept and meaning of digital media. So it is basically any media that are encoded in a machine readable form, right? And digital media contents can be created, distributed, stored on digital electronic devices. Digital media is any information that can, in digital media, any information, information can be in form of texts, pictures, video, audio, etc. That we can see through a screen, right? That we can see through a screen, right? Which is placed in front of us. For example, right now we are using our phone or, you know, our tablets or our computer screen to be on this video conferencing Google Meet. So it's coming to us through a screen. And what is over here meant by created, stored, and distributed? I'll just give you an example. Suppose we are editing an audio, right? Say I'm editing an audio on any software, which could be open source or, you know, proprietary. So, we can create the content, right? We can creating a content. Same goes for video creation. Also, we can create the content. We can store the content there. We can export the content into an MP3, MP4, whichever file we feel like. Or, you know, we can also keep it. If we think that over here it's written now that we can store and we can also keep it for reuse. We can store it. An audio file can be stored as a WAV file. It can be stored so that we can again retrieve it and reuse it. Right? So digital media gives us the opportunity to do all these things. Okay. So next is we get digitized content. So digitized content as in video, audio, texts, graphics, blogs, applications, software. So I'll just give you an example. Just right at the beginning of this, before showing this PPT, you could see, and before ma'am was, moderate, she started off with a moderation. We could see a poster. Right, that is also something, a content that we.
Anuna, you have to present the screen again. Somebody, started presenting. So.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So just tell me if the moment someone does, I again have to, Okay, is it visible?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So, as I said, any digital content that can be stored, retrieved, reused, and most importantly, distributed, right? Because if we don't distribute the content cannot reach to so many people, right? So the content needs a widespread distribution, and internet gives us this facility to distribute our content that we have created with the help of the digital devices. So, with the over here, if you see the last point that, with the advent of internet, digital media has advanced further. Of course, with the advent of internet, digital media has advanced in every possible way, right? So, moving on to the next slide, huh? Yeah. So now over here, I've mentioned that, there are three phases. There were three, I'll just say what I tried to mean that they, previously, with the advent of internet came in during 1990s, 1974, and at the very beginning when everything started, and World Wide Web by Tim Berners-Lee, it came in 1991. So at the very inception of it, there was everything was coming. It was all these new technologies, new medium, it was all coming. So that phase was a data deficiency phase. There was a lack of data. There was a dearth of data, right? Then came the data collection phase. From 2000 to 2010. So at this point of time, the new technologies were coming out, electronic devices, mobile phones, smartphones, so many things were coming up. started the data collection phase. That means the gathering of data. And then from 2014 onwards, now there is so much of information. This is the data analysis phase. So there's so much of information that, you know, sometimes it feels like, you know, too much of information leading into information boom, something like that. So we have come a long way, right? So today, and not only this, with the help of digital media, today we know about machine learning and deep learning algorithms. So just to give an example about it, for example, if we tag a person on Facebook, you know, looking at the picture of that person, Facebook or any, you know, other social networking, you know, they identify the person, right? So this is through deep learning and machine learning. What is done is a machine is made smarter, right? So that it can undertake data-driven decisions. Like, you know, we make our machine smarter so that they can understand that what next step it is going to take, right? So yeah, so we can rightfully say that we are basically now we are living in a digital society, right? So why? Because our lives are absolutely entangled, you know, with all the digital devices every day in our everyday lives, because we keep on using them. So next slide, huh? Okay, so what all we can do with the help of digital media? One is we can build e-commerce websites like the Amazon, Flipkart, so on, and you know, professional blogging. Someone who is a very passionate writer. Okay, he really wants to, you know, disseminate his content to so many people, so he can start professional blogging, right? So, and just restricted to, you know, say one profession, that is, one has to be a writer. That person can have great culinary skills. That person can be some, you know, has he or she might have other expertise. So then you can make social marketing websites. You can also make community websites. What is community websites? It's basically when group of individuals, you know, they share common interest via email, blog, message, chat rooms, message groups, etc. Then search engine optimization. Through search engine optimization, what you can do is, you know, you can show your content, you know, you can make your content visible to a larger number of people if you have a target audience or a, you know, a particular audience you want them to see continuously. Continuous rounds in the internet. Then you can create graphic designs and then advanced templates creation. This is another very good feature of digital, one very good creation of this digital media, that is, you know, advanced templates creation. Nowadays, we have templates ready on which we can work, right? So, yeah. So, next slide is, the internet. Internet is basically a global interconnected network of computers, and it's a key invention of the digital society. So it all, you know, it started with the first computer network, that's ARPANET. ARPANET was, you know, it was, it worked on the TCP/IP protocol, and it came in around 1983. And, you know, from there, the researchers, they began to assemble the network of networks that later became the modern internet, which is today. And ARPANET, basically, it was used by the academicians and the militarists. So it had a social purpose to serve also. Yeah. So next, during the 1990s came the World Wide Web, which was developed by Tim Berners-Lee. Then I can say that, you know, internet functions as, it is basically, it functions as a transport mechanism where from one place you can, you know, you can keep on searching from one to the other to the other. It's a huge place, actually. Then www, it's basically, what is it? It's a hyperlink based information system that enables users to search from one information to another. So for example, nowadays, if we just open a news article or something, anything we want to search over the internet, we get that information, and from there we will see that, you know, there are various hyperlinks. Like if we click on that, we go to another information, we go to another content. Maybe from that content we will have other hyperlinks. Through that we can go to some other content. So this way, the chain of information is continuously, you know, it's not stopping, huh? Okay. So this is just to, you know, make you understand that, you know, this URL is basically www World Wide Web, where series of hyperlinks are connected to are connected through hyperlinks. And what is a URL? URL is basically a resource locator, uniform resource locator. And if we can locate anything in the internet that we want, we can get to that place by placing the URL. So these are the parts of the URL. See, this HTTP, it is basically the protocol. And what is a protocol? Protocol is something that is used by web browser to access HTML pages. Then comes the domain name. Suppose you are searching National Geographic channel. So this www.nationalgeographic.com, this is your domain name that is, you know, which identifies your network domain, and finally the path that locates a page or a post on the website. So the entire thing taken together, the protocol, domain name and path, everything taken together makes a URL that you get in the address bar. Okay, next is, if you look at the diagram, if you look at the page, you'll understand that, you know, we have traveled a long way from computing devices to smartphones and tablets. So previously there was difference engine, right, which could solve mathematical functions, which could basically solve addition, right? It was invented by Charles Babbage, the father of computers, and then came the analytical engine. Analytical engine could do addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and again it was designed by Charles Babbage. And at that point of time, Ada Lovelace used to work along with him. And Ada Lovelace, she has been the world's first programmer. So from digital engine and analytical engine, we have moved on to smartphones and tablets. So you can imagine the transition from mechanical things. We have moved on to smartphones, to tablets. Now we need to tap on the screen and get the world at the click of a button, right? So it is, the journey has been quite overwhelming, right? So next slide, moving on to the next slide is, the binary system. So computer understands binary. Yeah, it doesn't understand any other language. It understands binary, that is 0 or 1. And binary works on base 2. Binary system is basically a number system. There are 4 number systems, octal, binary, decimal, hexadecimal. And binary is that number system on which computer works. And it works on 0 and 1. And binary has a base 2, right? So rather than analog, I'll just read out. Rather than analog objects to convey information, it is about numbers and digits in binary. That is 0 and 1. Binary system for coding, computing, and controlling information was introduced by Gottfried Leibniz. In digital electronics, 0 means electricity is off. We have to understand this. 0 means there's no electricity. Yeah, and 1 means electricity is on. So basically, in the world, in the computing world, everything, you know, comes down to small micro transistors. And 1 micro transistor makes a byte. And 8 such, 1 micro transistor makes a bit. And 8 such bits make a byte, right? So so when we say that, suppose say 1001, here 1 means the switch is on. 0 means the switch is off. Again, 1 on, 0 off. So it works like this. So the conversion is, you know, how to convert any decimal to binary. Again, binary to decimal, it is just, you know, exemplified in form of this table that you can see in the right. But I have a video to show you all. So may I get the permission of showing a video to just exemplify this? Hello?
Yes, sir. Ananda, go on.
Okay. Just give me a moment, huh? Can everybody hear? I just put on the audio. Is it audible?
Not yet.
Then I'll just play. Yeah.
Play it.
Everything that a computer does comes down to what is known as a microtransistor.
Is it audible?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. I'm playing it again.
Everything that a computer does comes down to what is known as a microtransistor. So these are tiny switches that can go on and off. So these are microtransistors. One means on, zero means off, one means on and off. A single microtransistor is called a bit, whereas a combination of 8 bits make a byte. So the technique of working with numbers is called a number system, right? So decimal is the most commonly used one, which has a base 10, but a computer uses binary number system, which is base 2, because it uses 0 and 1. So now we'll convert these two numbers, 32 and 47. Let's start with 32 first. So the procedure is, we'll continuously divide it by 2 unless we get a remainder 0 or 1. So the answer will be, we'll go from down to top, 100000, which is the binary conversion of 32. Now let's try this number 47. We'll keep on dividing it by 2 unless we get a remainder 0 or 1. So the answer will be, again, we'll go from down to top, 101111.
Was it visible and audible?
Yes.
Okay. I'll carry on with the presentation. So I just explained the binary system, which works on electric pulses of these zeros and one. And now I will discuss, we'll talk about digital media and society. Digital media, you know, have put their mark in the society today, which is undeniable, and we know it. So most of the contents are created here. See, it can be created by ordinary people. Yeah, me, you, me, anyone. We can create any content that we feel like. So this is one of the key features of, you know, digital media, that we ordinary people, we can create contents here. We can store contents. We can retrieve content. We can distribute content, because we have our digital devices at hands, and we have the internet to as a medium to, you know, to just distribute it, make it a mass distribution, right? So then, unlike traditional media, it works faster and has a participatory approach. So the difference between, basic difference is that, you know, traditional media, basically there's this feedback mechanism is extremely restricted. But in case of digital media, if we can see social media platform, there are comments. In digital media, if you can also see news articles over there, also you will see the comment section. Okay, in maybe a YouTube video or anything, wherever. So it comes with this feedback approach, right? So this is one of the key features of digital media. So, and it makes it all the more participatory and a very democratic platform, right? But anyway, it also comes with not only with benefits, it also comes with detriments. Like, you know, when it is a participatory approach, anyone can comment everything. So contents become very hard to control at times, right? So digital media affects social by playing a large role in the process of mediatization. That is a process stimulated by digital technologies. I think it's self-explanatory. I don't need to say. According to scholar Marshall McLuhan, translation of culture happens alongside the introduction of new media technologies. And people use various applications like, you know, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. And this way, they are also contributing to the culture, right? If you are, suppose you are singing something, you posted it on YouTube, you can, you're making it go, you know, in front of so many people so that people can see. So in a way, the culture is, you know, you're actually shaping them. You're shaping your content, and in turn also you are also getting, you know, you are also reinventing yourself. So this is so we can rightfully say that we are living in a digital society nowadays. So moving on to the next slide, I would like to talk a bit about, you know, digital communication. So today, nowadays, it is more of a digital communication, especially if we have to take this period of COVID into consideration. It's we are completely restricted to digital communication. So it's extremely important in today's world, huh? So, and then transfer of data over point to point or point to multiple point communication channels, right? So it's not that, you know, my point to point, as in when I'm, you know, texting a particular person or sending a particular video or an audio to a particular person, and point to, you know, multiple point as in, you know, suppose this, take for example this, I'm showing the PPT and so many people who have come here, who have been so kind to come and watch this presentation, they can see. So it's so many, so it's point to multiple points. So then communication performed by using digital technology with the help of internet connectivity. I just, you know, went through that. Another key feature is, you know, it is not always important that, you know, the contents that we create, it not always needs an internet connection to create those content also. Without internet connectivity also we can create. But of course, to distribute it, we need internet connectivity. Like for example, I will again show something. I just have two more slides to show, but I'll again show something. I'll exemplify what I meant and show something. Just a minute. Yeah. So this is a experimental tool that I've made using PowerPoint. So when we are working on PowerPoint, we don't need internet connectivity. But just to prove this point, I wanted to show this. This is what I made. This is an animated content. So this is basically, there is a battery. It is named as SNCW. It's acronym for our college. And then there is this off on button and there is this bulb. So the main idea is to, you know, keep the current flowing. When I put the on switch, the bulb will be lit up. When I again put the off switch, the bulb will be switched off, right? So let's switch it on. So the bulb is on, right? Now I switched it off. So again, let's do it again. Off. So again, on, off. So the point to show this is, to make this, I did not require internet connectivity. But to show this to you all, I did need the internet connectivity. So digital media, it comes with these benefits also. Again, going back to my PPT, I'll just end it.
I have few portions to skip.
Yeah. So just said, and now, and another thing is that we can launch applications. We can, you know, we can be app developers. We can launch our own applications. We can design our app. We can launch them on Play Store, and we can get reviews over there. Also, there is a provision of, you know, of review. People can review those apps. They can give, you know, say 2-star, 3-star, depending upon the content that you have created. And we can communicate with audience, as there is a provision for feedback. So next is digital journalism. So digital journal, I wanted to talk about it at length, but I'll just, you know, just mention a few points. But digital journalism has become very, very important, indispensable nowadays. It's basically any form of journalistic content posted on internet, like, you know, articles, pictures, video, graphic. And people like to watch journalistic contents on digital media. Why? Because the articles are not very lengthy. Unlike in traditional media, newspapers, you have to read, you know, the entire news story. People don't have the patience, you know, to read the entire. Probably they'll just read the intro and fold the newspapers, or just, you know, switch over quickly to the other, to another news item, or news article. So, but in case of digital journalism, the news articles are, you know, much smaller in size. And of course, they're not too long, right? And people can, you know, get this 24/7. And because of this digital journalism, one thing that, you know, a key feature of digital journalism is, suppose you just, you know, install an app. Say you're installing ABP app or Hindu. So what you get is you get push notifications. You get notifications throughout the day. So even if you want to miss, even if you're not in, you know, in a, not interested in, you know, you're not interested, the notifications will keep coming so that you can watch it later. So this is a very great, this is one of the great benefits of this, of digital journalism that it brings to us. Then GIF, that can be used as contents of information. Hyperlink that we discussed, it can be used, and there is also use of hashtags, which has been very common, which has been in vogue nowadays. We can use it in, we can see this in social media platform, and also in case of digital journalism, journalists use hashtags. Why? Because hashtags, you know, they enhance the popularity of your story. And it helps you to track a story, right? So there are there is a lot of usage of hashtags. And yeah, so moving on to the next is finally the advantages and disadvantages of digital media. So number one is of course it facilitates social interactions and it empowers people. Why? Because when you create something, you feel empowered because it's your content. You have created it. So, you know, so increases civic participation. Of course, today we have assembled here in this video conferencing, you know, platform, and we have come here for a, you know, healthy discussion on digital media. So it's, you know, civic participation. It is all, you know, benefited because of digital media. Then it boosts productivity. It's self-explanatory. I won't go with that. Then enhances flexibility of workers and employees. You can work on it anytime. You know, you can work on it at night, at daytime, anytime you feel like. So there's no time constraint, right? So then instant communication between people. Then GPS and mapping helps you to go from one place to the other. Then online banking, finance, etc. All these things have made it all the more, you know, innovative, helpful for us. And, you know, we are, as I say, I would again reiterate my words that we are living in a digital society. And finally, the disadvantages of digital media. So it does come with a lot of its own detriments. It has its privacy concern, you know, because, you know, it can be hacked. There can be a lot of privacy issues. So I won't get into detail. Then social disconnect. Yeah, when it's very much you know, seen in people that they are so much engrossed in their mobile phones and their tablets and their smart devices that they don't have for social time for social gatherings. So, you know, it kinds of making you secluded from the society, you know. So that's one problem that can be a problem. Then digital media manipulation, right? So what content you get, you feel like, okay, I need to buy this. Maybe this looks so tempting. This looks so good. Kind of persuasive communication also, you get a hint of that. then plagiarism and copyright. So this, so to prevent this, like, you know, there can be images, like images, videos that they come with their own copyrights. But to, you know, to use any image or any content free from copyright, you have to select that option, like label for reuse and modification, so that you can reuse and modify. If the owner of that particular image or that particular content gives you the permission, it's you know, he or she just, you know, put that in the internet for as, you know, label for reuse and modification, then you can use it. Otherwise, it's a copyrighted, it's a copyright item. Then addiction, yeah, I don't need to say about it. So again, self-explanatory. Kids were so much drowned in PUBG that it now it's banned. Then data security, again, about this privacy concern and all, data security is linked. So with that, I would like to end my presentation, and just one line to say that, you know, communication should never stop. Communication is an act of hope for future. So thank you so much. Over to Atushi.
Thank you, Ananya. And now it's Atushi, okay? Atushi, take it over.
Good afternoon to all, and thank you so much, ma'am. I won't take much time, as Ananya has very beautifully shared a lot of things, the basics of digital media. So with your permission, I'll just quickly share the screen, my presentation.
Okay, it's yours.
Ma'am, is it visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay, thank you. So as you can see, quickly I'll share some, you know, data with you for starting. But to start, actually, what happens every minute on the internet? And it's a report which tells you, as of April 2020, the internet reaches 59% of the world's population. And these, you know, the text which is there on your screen, it's very well, you know, you can quickly identify with it. And many of you may find yourself, you know, busy with some or the other the entire day, especially in this pandemic. So obviously we can see that, you know, consumers spend almost $1 million, you know, online, and how many, you know, users are sharing, like, what is the number of WhatsApp messages shared, then the shipping, you know, online shopping, the same as Ananya was sharing. So Amazon ships so many packages, then, you know, application on LinkedIn, Facebook users share, Twitter gains new users, YouTube uploads, and then Instagram posts, Netflix users stream you know, so many hours of video, and obviously the Zoom meetings, and now, you know, Google Meet. So I'll just quickly share with you the next visual with you, digital population across India as of January 2020 in millions. So you can see the first bar shows you the active mobile users, you know, active mobile social media users, then, you know, active social media users. Then the third graph is about active mobile internet users, active internet users. So we can see that, you know, with the introduction of government's Digital India Initiative, you know, it contributed a lot to increase the internet penetration over the recent years. And it resulted in countries' digital population amounting to almost 688, you know, million active users as of, you know, January 2020. And it has become the second largest world's traffic of internet market, which I will show you in the, you know, further visuals. So the next graph which I have with you for you is, you know, distribution of internet users in India in 2019 by the age group. So you can see, you know, starting from 12 to 15 years to 16 to 19, 20 to 29 years, like they forms the majority, 30 to 29 years, 40 to 49 years, and 50 plus years. So around 54% of Indian internet users, the base is the user base is from, you know, 20 to 39 years, as, you know, in early into 2019. So I want to share here a newspaper article of TOI, obviously, which you know clearly mentioned that India is the second largest after China. And the latest report by Internet and Mobile Association of India, IAMAI, and the Nielsen, they showed this report, right? So we can see how, you know, the rural India has, you know, more internet users. So the scene is, you know, we get a very clear picture how much you know we are into internet now, right? So so now we know that internet is growing, we are getting access to internet, but you know, what is digital media literacy? There is a term which we often talk about. Earlier it was media literacy, now we are talking about digital media literacy. So what is digital media literacy? So very, you know, in very easier words, I want to, you know, sum it up, I can say that the ability to access, understand, and participate or create content using the digital media is digital media literacy. But there are lot of things, you know, which are gradually creeping in digital media literacy. It also involves the functional skills of, you know, reading and writing digital texts. What is reading a website? You know, all the hyperlinks which are, you know, available on a website, you should be, a person should be able to, you know, navigate through those hyperlinks to get the maximum information, to download, to upload. So all these things. So how you are capable of reading a website, and also writing, you know, now the writing parts come when you make, you know, either you are publishing a blog of your own, you are uploading digital photos on social media, you are, you know, writing a petition, and you know, you are now, we can see on Facebook lot of, you know, on birthdays, for some cause you are contributing, and you are, you know, awareing, you know, you are making awareness, you're spreading awareness to contribute for a social cause. Also, how, you know, digital media literacy also includes how particular, you know, communication technologies, they affect the meanings they convey, you know, whether you are tweeting, whether you are sharing a post. So, and you also need to, in digital media literacy, you should gain the ability to analyze and evaluate the knowledge which is available on the web. Children are, we have seen that, you know, the young, I have written children here, but the young generation, they are engaging more than ever before with the technology and digital media. And Mark Prensky, you know, he describe today's youth as digital natives. You know, they are better equipped to live and learn in the 21st century. So for them, the switch is very easy. So why is digital media literacy important? So there are, we normally say that it's very important to be, you know, media literate, digital media literate, because it is an important prerequisite to effective participation. Ananya also already talked a bit about it. So, you know, for effective participation in the digital economy, for its development, it is really very important, because the development will be constrained. It will be, you know, somehow it won't further if citizens are limited in their ability to participate because they don't have the adequate skills. And to, you know, exemplify in easier words, I can say that, you know, there are, you know, when we are doing online classes through, you know, virtual online classes, then obviously some students sometimes, if their you know, network connectivity is not good, or maybe they do not have access to, you know, a good internet connection, they feel deprived of the classes, the interaction which they can have if they have a better, you know, a connectivity. Or even sometimes, you know, some students, when they are given assignments, they the students who have the knowledge or who are trained enough to, you know, use the digital skills, they can present, you know, in a more effective way, and so they can submit their assignments in a, you know, better, attractive way. So it is very important for the development of our digital economy. Those who are unable to participate, they feel sometimes, you know, excluded from the benefits, because digital media is now, you know, it's inherent in our social, cultural, and economic life. Those who have low levels of digital literacy will also, you know, they sometimes feel less confident. Sometimes a student may hesitate to even unmute and talk in the class. So, you know, we may say that if you have low levels of digital literacy, they may feel a bit of, you know, they may feel less of confidence or sometimes knowledge, or they sometimes, you know, face difficulty in understanding, or, you know, so to participate in a safe, secure, and in an informed manner in a digital economy, in a communication environment, we need to have, you know, we need to cultivate better digital media literacy. It is very important now. So digital media, you know, a digital literate person should be able to understand the nature of different types of digital services and content they provide. They should have the basic capacity and competence to get connected and operate, access various digital technologies, confidently participating in services provided by digital technologies. And if they are participating, they can make informed choices in online digital media and communications environment. They will have, you know, and they should have an adequate level of knowledge and skills to be able to protect themselves and their families from unwanted, inappropriate, and unsafe, you know, content. So what are the aspects of digital literacy? The first is information literacy. The first term when we talk about digital literacy is information literacy. There are lots of information available online. We should be, you know, capable enough to manage and use the information. We should know which information to trust, which information source to trust. So that becomes the first aspect of digital literacy. Media literacy, obviously, when we have you know, access to different media channels, television, you know, that is available online now. We have live streaming of news, radio, podcasts, then we have e-newspapers. So we can access all these, you know, we should have the ability to access from where we can get. We should be able to analyze, evaluate, and create messages across a variety of contexts. That includes media literacy. Multi-literacies. We have to be, you know, proficient. Multi-literacy basically tells you about proficiency in various literacies, like not just reading and writing, listening, speaking. You have to develop a skill in digital literacy, which is, you know, which consists of multiple of skills which are there. And then the critical digital literacy includes, it's a combination of both the functional skills and the technical skills. You know, the technical skills need to be integrated with the critical thinking because when you are exposed to various messages through digital platforms, paying attention to wider issues. Also, you need to know then how and why this is happening, or how and why we use computers or a particular platform. We should have a thorough knowledge of that particular platform which we are using. So a critical thinking and technical skills both should be used in combination. And how these messages which are available, you know, through different digital platforms, how the text or the video content, how it affects the meaning that we produce and receive. So these are the four aspects of digital literacy. Moving on to the next slide. So as we said, we talked about participation in digital world. We know that why digital literacy is important, when we know that what skills we should have, what are the aspects we should work on when we want ourselves, or we can say that we are digitally literate, so then our participation will gradually increase. So what is participation? How can you participate in the digital world? You can have affiliations with communities such as Facebook and online games, activities in which participants create new form of expression through, you know, e-magazines, fan fiction writing, mashups, storytelling. There are a lot of things which are happening all around India and across the globe. So some, music mashups, these things are quite, popular nowadays. What is other way of, participating? You can be in collaborations where learners work with others to complete tasks, Google Sheets, where we can, in collaborations, we are, uploading some marks, or, we are creating something. When teachers are, normally I'll give you example with how I participate in the digital world is basically the entire week's classes. So they are shared over digitally. We are, sharing what contents I have taught, and then somebody is there to compile it and all. So collaborations, you can collaborate with other learners. Research has become very easier. Lots of digital libraries are there where, you can access free ebooks and contents. And the content of my today's lecture is also an outcome of my, membership in such an e-digital, digital library. So again, when you are writing in, editing a Wikipedia, you are collaborating, or you are gaming with, friends who are out, in different corners of the India, then you are collaborating. What else? You can engage in activities which users shape the circulation or flow of media through forms such as podcasting and blogging. So these are the various ways you can participate in the digital world. So what are the challenges? So challenges are basically, when people have unequal access to opportunities and experiences and skills, the knowledge that needs to, this needs to be addressed. Another challenge can be, when we talk from the perspective of students, they need to understand how media shape perceptions of the world, how digital media is shaping perceptions, and they should be encouraged to, learn this new normal, maybe. Ethical issues are there. Young people need to be prepared for their increasingly public roles as media makers. When they are posting something on Facebook or on Instagram, they need to be prepared. They need to understand that they are now playing a role. They are playing the role of a media maker in a community. Somebody is there to follow, somebody is liking whatever they are writing, so it affects people. So they should be made aware about that. Technology in schools and college, sometimes challenges is there to make it a part of a curriculum. Sometimes technology in schools and colleges work as a challenge. As I talked about, when there is an, internet connections are not good enough, the equipments which we require, so the hardware, software, sometimes they pose as a challenge to, making a person digitally literate, or, including this in a curriculum. There are lots of policies and procedures regarding ICT, and there are some, maybe each and everybody cannot be given computers and all, so that may also come as a challenge. I won't be taking much time. I know that we are running out of time, so I'll just quickly sum up. If teachers, educators, if they are unfamiliar with the technology, if they are unfamiliar with the digital media, the advantages, then sometimes they will not use it imaginatively for learning purposes. We as educators, when we are starting the new semester, we know how good it is, how easy it has become to teach, take classes online. We just you know, thousands and millions of YouTube videos are just a click away. Whenever some student want, you know, ki, okay, we want some new examples, we can just, you know, show various animated content. We can, you know, some slides are available, some good quality things are available on internet, and we can, you know, very easily use it for, you know, learning purposes. So for that, the educators, the teachers also have to become familiar with the use of the technology. So that if we can use it, if technology needs to become, you know, fully, meaningfully integrated throughout the curriculum. So I will conclude now, as I promised that I'll quickly wind out. So we understood, you know, I talked throughout the my presentation, what is digital media literacy, how it is important, what are the challenges, and what are the, you know, prerequisites, what are the things I should keep in mind when I am exposed to the digital media content. So by developing the digital literacy of learners through curriculum, educators are enabling them to contribute, you know, to the, you know, their increased participation. Educators are enabling them, and also we as educators are able to contribute to the enhanced learning process, you know, the potential, by using the potential of digital media. So when I am enhancing young people's ability to use digital media, then their skills are strengthening, their knowledge is increasing, they understand the content in a better way, and their capacity to function in the social, cultural, civic, and economic, you know, development of the country, you know, increases. So with that, I conclude. Thank you so much for your patient listening.
Thank you, Atoshi and Anunna. It was very informative and very crisp, if I could use the word. It was very crisp, and hope all the participants had followed it well and had, you know, they did take back many things from your deliverances. But before concluding, I would like to thank the digital media, because all the time we had a participation of over 100 today. So all the time, and it is really an achievement for all of us here. And primarily, I would like to thank Dr. Umashankar Pandey. You know, it is his brainchild. This web lecture series is his brainchild. And I would also like to thank my senior colleagues, Shottabrata Pal, Shrabani Mukhopadhyay, and Panka Mojumdar Nag, for their constant support. And, you know, they are being pillars all through this department, for this department. And Atoshi and Anunna, again, a special mention. Very well conducted, very well said, and very well presented. So thank you all for your patience and your participation. It truly means a lot for this department, and we encourage this participation, and we wish to meet you again next week with some other new professor addressing you all, and of course we want to see you again. Thank you. So Mother, your last words, please, for this session.
Thank you very much. I mean, as a teacher, I can't be more proud. Both of them are my students. I have taught Atoshi at our college from 2005 to 2008, and at the university after that. I've taught Anunna in 2011 and 12. So really, really happy with the way, you know, they've presented. They've covered almost everything that can be. And thanks to Ushoshi, our colleague, for almost 16 years now, that, you know, you moderated it so smoothly that, you know, there was no flaw for a second. So thank you very much to all our other colleagues, and I'm so happy that, you know, we've had participation from very many different parts of the country. We've had Suresh Gaurji, he's a very senior public relations professional, and we've had Shorab Gupta, we've had Deborshi, we've had, you know, so many colleagues joining us, and that's a very good thing, because, you know, it's very important for colleagues to stand by each other for such web lectures. And all of us, you know, we keep learning, and this has been such a wonderful learning process. I'm sure in the coming weeks too, we'll have a lot more, you know, to learn in terms of journalism and mass communication studies and other fields of journalism. We'll be looking forward to Shatubrat Paul's presentation. We'll be looking to Ushushi Rai Sengupta's presentation. We're looking forward to Konka Mojumdar's presentation. We're looking forward to Shabani Mukhopadhyay as well. Jyoti, you know, she's had a very unfortunate bereavement in her family, so she's taking some time off. So all our condolences to her and everybody in her family, and I'm sure she'll be back very soon. Thanks again to all the participants, and we've had some discussions in the chat box as well. And over 100 people, we had about 125 plus at different times. So I'm so happy that you worked hard, and that too in a very short amount of time, because it was late on probably on Wednesday that you got to know that Jyoti wouldn't be able to present. So you took up the same topic that somebody else was planning for a longer time. So I'm really happy the way it has worked out, and we've been privileged to have had very senior teachers from different parts of the country praising this effort. Dr. S. N. Behra, he called me up and said that, this is such a good exercise. Professor S. K. Behra, he wrote down in one of those groups that, it's so refreshing to listen to a younger colleague. So I'm sure that we'll keep having that. And it doesn't look like, this is your second or third presentation online. You've been doing really, really well. So thank you very much, everyone. I'm sure everyone has sent in their feedback links, because very soon we'll be sending out the certificates. In fact, by 6 this evening, you'll get all your certificates and the YouTube link. So thank you again. If anyone wants to add anything, you can come on online. If Suresh is online, I would invite him to. Suresh Gorji, if you want to say something. Are you online, sir? I don't think that he can hear us. We've had many other colleagues. So anyway, if anyone wants to add something to it, or if you have any observations, you are welcome to add, or we'll call it a day and meet you next Saturday, where we'll have a presentation on contemporary sports journalism. So that would be a very interesting presentation next week as well. Thank you, everybody. So we are ending the meeting right here. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, moderators. Thank you, presenters.
And thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, dear colleagues, students, and a lot of other people I could see. We've had colleagues like Shubhuji Dacharya. So thank you for coming. Shaurav, would you like to say something? Dr. Shaurav Gupta from Central University of Odisha, would you like to say something?
Yes. Good afternoon to all of you. And I congratulate Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey, Umada, and the faculty colleagues in the Department of Journalism and Mass Communication at Surendranath College for Women for this wonderful collective exercise. And I think this is really refreshing to see that Umada is backing up his colleagues and actually encouraging them to come up with their presentations. And whatever I experienced today, it was very nice, informative, and insightful. And I am sure that this exercise will add to the academic endeavors and the profile of the department. I have drawn a lot of inspiration from today's session. Thank you very much, Umada.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gupta. Thank you for joining, and thank you for pitching in. So thank you again. So we end the meeting here.